to our panelists tonight. I'm going to go in order, starting with Chet Singh. Chet Singh is an amazing person. He's he is a contributing editor to the college textbooks from social analysts to social change. Two of his Duck Poets poems appeared in the 2011 documentary, Capitalism is a Crisis. And how would you call it, placement ad time? Please, by his amazing... placement product. I believe there's coffees back there, no? But he has...
Yeah, they're on the table. They're donation free. He's graciously donated them.
Yeah, so please give freely to such an important cause. When you pick up one of these CDs, we would really appreciate it. Last but not least, he's a professor at Centennial College. And so that's Chet Singh. Next to him is Lester Alfonso, who is also an amazing person. They're all amazing, of course. He's a Peterborough-based writer, filmmaker, a photographer, a video jockey, and radio host. He's produced, directed, and written a really awesome movie called 12. His latest production was called Lost and Found in Jackson Creek, which was debuted at the just the recent film festival here in Peterborough. And he is currently working on his new production, which is called Birthmark. And that also, this production is going to be talking about inclusion as well. And it's a film about the marks we are born with and the marks we imagine ourselves. So that's in the works. So please, when it comes out, we're going to get a full house to see that one. And if you haven't seen any of his other productions, I totally recommend them because they're just really out of this world. Okay, and right beside Lester is Niambi. Leigh? And she's Jamaican born. Shout out to Jamaicans. poet, and she currently lives in Peterborough. And she's very active in the poetry community. And I hope that she does some poetry because you have to see her. She's just a really good poet. Excellent. A lot of passion when she does her poetry. She was, this year in 2015, we were in the National Poetry Slam up in, I think, Saskatchewan. Yeah, and she did really well. Next is Carlos. Carlos Q, I think he said. Is that right? And he's so modest. He only gave me, he's a cool kid. What more do we say about Carlos? He's a cool kid. And you gotta add him. He wants you guys to know. He wants you to add him on Facebook or email him. But Carlos has also been involved in a lot of youth initiatives here in Peterborough. He's I know that he has been involved in Jamaica Self Help youth program that they had. And he's been in BAM, building a movement as well. So he's a very active young man. Yay. We save the best to last. And Liz Stone, which is probably the easiest name I'm going to say as best. So please forgive me because. I have a bit of a speech difficulties, and especially when I'm nervous. So I'm going to try to say all these words. Executive director, that was easy. Anish Ki Wendida. Okay. And Anishna Ba
4,000 children die every day from poverty-related diseases. In Canada, we throw away 24 billion of food annually. Did you know that? All right. So we that live in the West benefit from this structural arrangement that the elites have designed. And as a result, in addition to the displacement of people, there's the destruction of the environment. Not only are former Western colonizers engaged in these processes, we now have Chinese elites, Indian elites, Saudi Arabians, Israelis, elites colonizing and displacing other people around the globe. And I mention this not to be dramatic, but to suggest that my migration to Canada is linked to these historical processes, these economic and political realities. The first time I came to Canada would have been in the 70s, late 70s. And the reason that I came to Canada was because of U.S. imperialism. A socialist prime minister was about to be elected in Jamaica, and the CIA unloaded a massive amount of weaponry that they distributed to the local gangs. You had a lot of people dying in Jamaica. The population, 2 million, I think there was like over 2,000 people dying, 1,000 to 2,000 people dying from gun violence. Basically, they destabilized the country. And so, you know, why do people leave situations like that? You know, people who can't afford to, the economic migrants you speak of, they go to Canada, Miami, and these kinds of places, right? And so I was part of that. I went back to Grenada because I wanted to be part of the socialist revolution and the Doom Jewel movement. But I had to leave because the United States invaded. That was after I finished training. The United States invaded. I still went. This was months before I went. I got badly beaten up. So I came back to Peterborough.
Thank you.
Now, so these processes are linked to imperialism, but secondly, also to the displacement of Indigenous peoples in Canada. Immigration specifically in Canada is linked to the displacement, the ongoing colonization, and the apartheid-like conditions of First Nations in Canada. Let's face it, when you have different policies for this, different people, that's apartheid. They don't have the same funding for education, social services, et cetera, et cetera. That's apartheid. Apartheid, by the way, came from Canada when the South African government came here in the 1940s and adopted what we're doing now with the reservation system. And third, it's linked to the growth of capitalism in Canada. Canada is a so-called settler colony, right? Like Australia and New Zealand. And we're...
I came to Canada at age 12. I was brought by my family over for a better life. For more of an in-depth rendition of that story, you can watch my film 12. It's on the National Film Board website. It's also on my website at restaurantmonster.com. It's about 12 people who all came to Canada at age 12, so it really gives you a composite story of one experience. So that was in the early 80s. We went to Windsor, Ontario, and the atmosphere at that time was very tense around Asian immigrants because at that time there was a recession and Japanese car imports were blamed for the recession. And because it was in Windsor, it was a big, Windsor, it's an automotive capital of Canada, and Detroit was right across the river. That tension was very palpable when I moved there. So I was literally, as a 12-year-old, scared to be myself, scared to show myself. At that time, when I arrived, there was a news story on TV that Vincent Chin was killed in Detroit in a parking lot after he grabbed something from a McDonald's with a baseball bat. He slammed crushed his skull because they said that he was Japanese and they blamed him for the Japanese car imports, even though he was Chinese. So that was the atmosphere that I moved to Windsor, Canada. Shortly after that, as you'll get to see in 12, if you see it, because really I was interviewing a new immigrant in the film, and she kind of reversed the tables on me at that moment. I didn't plan to tell my story, but she said, "Hey, were you ever bullied before?" And I had to actually, at that moment, it was unplanned, but I had to say that I was waiting for my bus to go home after school, and about 9 to 10 guys were throwing stones at me from the gravel. So and someone was kind of defending me, saying, "Hey, he knows karate." Also, kind of a racial, slur. So don't throw stones at him. He knows karate. I never told that story until that moment that it was filmed. I was embarrassed to tell my parents. My parents didn't know until they saw the movie. Because I really thought it was my fault or something at that age. I really thought, I was really upset that that the inside wasn't seen. That I really want to show my inside, that I'm a good person inside, that this exterior doesn't necessarily say that I'm a bad person. So that was the atmosphere that I came into. Luckily, I was encouraged to tell my story, and as I tell my story more and more, we get that connection, we get that understanding. So that's my immigrant experience.
When I was asked to speak on this panel, I came to Canada from Jamaica when I was 13, about a week before my 14th birthday, and so most of the issues I faced when I first came to Canada was around being in school and having to interact with people through that lens, and my mom handled a lot of the talking to different organizations and getting us settled, and so when I was asked to speak on this panel, I thought it best to ask her perspective on these questions, just because I feel that she has input that is valid. We came to Canada around the time when there was a really high rise in violent crimes in Jamaica, especially for children. A lot of children were being kidnapped, and a lot of girls especially were being taken and brutally beaten and raped, and just already was a Canadian citizen, and we were established enough there to find a way to come here. Healthcare fees in Jamaica are very, very expensive, and you don't have to pay that much for healthcare here. But my mom has 4 kids, and all 4 of us had asthma, and when you're younger, asthma is a lot less easy to navigate, and so that also played a very, very big part in us coming. There's also this idea in most island countries of the American or the North American dream, where it's the grass is greener. Uh-huh. On the other side, if you go to foreign, then your life will be better and you can get a job and make your family back home life better. So we came here with that mentality too, wanting to be able to send money to our family members back home or send them clothes or help them with papers, because we were in a situation where we have better access to systems that will help you navigate those things to be able to send back to them. And so that is the reason why we came to Canada. When we came to Canada, we lived in Mississauga for a bit, and then we went to Campbellford, which was really, really rough, because we were the only black family in the entire community, and it was not fun, because it's also a retirement town, and so most of the people are older and not that conscious of applying awareness to the programs and things that they were taught when they were younger, and so that was really hard for us in terms of my mom and dad not being treated with respect. My mom went through a lot of things where she felt like she was treated as illiterate or incompetent because of her accent. My sisters and I, we were all in a Niambi tribe, and we were Rastafarian when we initially moved here, and so we all had dreads and were really connected to our culture, and in school we got teased a lot and eventually went through the process of cutting off our hair because we didn't feel like it made us feel pretty, and it was just a lot of having to shape yourself to fit a whole new space that you didn't even really want to come to in the first place. And so that's my story. Migration.
Thank you. Thank you everyone for having me. Thank you. Thanks for recognizing my coolness. So my relationship to this land gave me the chance to experience. This land gave me the chance to mourn, to celebrate, to exist, to live, to remember. It gave me the chance to experience those emotions, the land that was taken away from me. I'm so deeply disconnected to my land, and I'm so happy that I got to experience that in here. And also, I feel like I'm an intruder, because like I was forced to come here, and then I was forced by like the European settler government. And then my experience here is without consent, with like proper consent with like the indigenous community. It's like, hey, I don't know, am I making sense?
Yeah.
That's good. Yeah, I'm torn between those emotions, like, where do I belong? Like, am I, is it okay to be here? Or like, yeah, okay. So my existence here started with my mom. So my mom came here and came through like to the live-in caregiver program, Carmela was saying. And then, but I want you all to know that my mom was forced to come here. Like most of the workers, we are all forced here. This is the only option we had. We had to find work. We had to escape poverty, or like at least find something, you know? So my mom worked for this person, and then with the terms of the program, my mom is locked with her employer. So I remember my mom telling me that she couldn't leave the employer's house, even on her days off, because her employer needed her in case of emergency. So basically, my mom worked every day without any break time. My mom got sick of it, so she tried to go out of that employer. But the employer coerced her and then say stuff like, I'm gonna cancel your employment. And then that could have been really drastic for my mom. My mom was really in a dangerous position. But that's my mom's story to tell you. So here's my story. So six work years has passed. My mom got the opportunity to like brought us here. So now I'm here. I'm sitting here doing some radical stuff. So my activism is grounded and is cultivated in this land, in Nogo Jingmanaw. Like all of you are like organizers that I've like come through. All of you are my friends and like new faces. Like we can all be friends and then all that stuff. So yeah, and I'd like to like acknowledge that too. So like hashtag Team Peterborough. That's it. And then thank you.
And now we have Liz.
Bonjour. So my immigration to Canada started in the '60s when I was born. And it's been a hard relationship with the land. It's been a sad relationship with the land. The land is very important to me and my family. Unfortunately, my story and my relationship with the land has been full of hurt. It's been full of shuffling. It's been full of being shuffled, and it's been full of being pushed all over the place. even though I wasn't a part of this, but to me and my family, unfortunately, my story and my relationship with the land has been full of hurt. It's been full of shuffling. It's been full of being shuffled, and it's been full of being pushed all over the place. Even though I wasn't a part of this land in 1492 or late 1400s, I continue to be shuffled all over the place. So my two communities, which I introduced myself at the beginning, Omjanali and Bedasigi, are actually Sarnia and Petoskey, Michigan. So in Sarnia, it's the land there and the community there is so sick that it's not safe for me to be in my community. And in Bedasigi or Petoskey, they made me Polish because they couldn't say Bedasigi, which is what I am. My grandfather's, however many greats, there's a statue of him in the center of Petoskey, and they used his Christian name and a Polish name on there, and he's pointing out over the harbor. He's pointing out over our territory, and it's not even his name. It says Ignace Petoskey. Ignatius or Ignace Petoskey. And so my story and my relationship to the land is not being able to live in my community, is not being able to settle in my community, and not be able to introduce the land in my communities and all of its glories to my children and share in that. It's not safe for me to live in Sarnia or Anjou. It's not safe for me to bring my son there. It's not safe for me to bring my nieces and my nephews there. And it's not safe for me in Petoskey because they took that territory away. And the historical factors of my life, I didn't go to residential school, but my family moved us off reserve so that my grandparents on one side worked in residential school, and on the other side, they became Roman Catholics, so they wouldn't be taken away. They were good Christians. So they wouldn't be taken away. And it was just a generation after generation of moving all over the place. I've lived in Detroit. I was born in the States. I've lived in Windsor area, 20 minutes south, in a small town where they still do have the bylaw that people of color can't live within the city limits. I've lived in Peterborough, where people have assumed I'm going to the hospital for narcotics. I've lived in places in the city where people assume that when I'm walking down the street after dark, that I'm working, and not on my way home from work. So my relationship to the land, although it's very, very, very important to me, it's been a very hurtful relationship, and not of our own choosing.
The reason the CRRC came to be was because in the summer of 1983, I think it was, 42 Nigerian students were physically and verbally assaulted. And it wasn't just Nigerian students, and that was only what was recorded. When all of that was happening, the institutions of power in the community refused to do anything about it. Czechs didn't report about it until they were forced to eventually. I don't know if Czechs is here. But they wanted news reporting for multiculturalism when they did do that story on the racial assaults against the Nigerian students. The church, many of these students belong to the Catholic Church, refused to do anything about it. Peterborough police said, well, you know, that's what happens when, you know, you have black guys dancing with white women. Many of these assaults occurred after, you know, the King George. That was a kind of a disco that many students went to, and there were a lot of those assaults occurred there. And on, right? It was really the activism of these, you know, students and professors like Ken Tracy, McLaughlin, who forced the people, community, and the institutions to actually address this issue, basically by threatening an economic boycott and advising students not to come to people. And that's when people actually responded. I don't know, this is part of the history of the CRRC. In any community, you're going to have people that are enlightened, that are progressive, you're going to have neoconservative, racist, sexist, misogynists, homophobes, you're going to have liberals. These ideologies circulated in all communities, and Peterborough, it was a very interesting place back then. I came back to Peterborough after I left York because I wanted to live in the land. I loved the land of Peterborough, and that's why I came back. And I was working at Sir Sanford Fleming College. I worked at many institutions, educational institutions, and I would have to say Fleming College and Trent at the time were some of the most hostile spaces for racialized people, women, and so on and so forth. And the reason for that is because around that time you had the NDP government in Ontario, and I was part of this program to ensure that all colleges and universities had a human rights policy period. Trent led the campaign to enforce the right to offend. They felt it was a right that academics had to be racist, sexist, homophobic in the classroom because of academic freedom. John Fekete wrote a book called Moral Panic, where he made claims like, well, you know, the reason why there's so many statistics about harassment and violence against women is because these organizations skew the statistics so they can get funding. Fleming was a very hostile place. I remember the executive director of the Community and Race Relations Committee was teaching a course that we put in place on diversity and human rights for the police ed students. The police ed students vandalized their car, wrote on the blackboard, "Nigger, go home," and threatened her, and so on and so forth. I went to the chair and I said, "Hey, what?"